Now we go on to the second installment of our discussion of the national movement, in which I hope to cover the period from roughly 1995, which is the time that the partition of Bengal takes place, to 1928. When on the eve, right, and on the eve of the civil disobedience. Now yesterday, we saw that in the 1890s, the Congress was torn between the moderates and the extremists. They were called moderates and extremists. They were often called, respectively, the old guard, that means the moderates, and the and the uncompromising nationalists, that is the extremists. So many names were given to them, but ordinarily they are known as moderates and extremists. The moderates were headed by Tilak, and after 1895, they controlled the Indian National Congress. The main organization was very much in the hands of Firoz Shah Mehta. Whereas Tilak and his supporters carried on their own movement with their own newspapers, essentially in Marathi, but they subsequently developed allies in both Bengal under Bipin Chandra Pal and in Punjab under Lala Lajpat. Many were there, people who supported both. The CID report said that Hazrat Mohani in his hostel room in Bakki Barak, that addressed us all, had the pictures of both Tilak and Gokhale in his room. So, both were widely admired in nationalist ranks. But the division was undermining the Congress organization, its congresses or its sessions were not very well attended now. And so Curzon, Lord Curzon, the Viceroy, in 1904, made a particular statement, a forecast and a statement of purpose. The Congress is tottering to its fall, and our task, that is the task of British government, is to carry it to its grave, that is to finish the Congress. Now there were perhaps three occasions where such a miscalculation was made by the government about the national movement. Once in 1904 by Curzon, as we shall see, then in 1920s with the announcement of the Simon Commission, and then in 1935 with the promulgation of the Act of 1935. At each of these turns it was expected that the Congress would, and the national movement would be defeated or would be greatly defeated. So in 1904, Curzon decided to take two steps, major steps. One was the Indian Universities Act of 1904. Indian universities had been established in 1857, the first three ones. Allahabad University, the others had come later. But these were examining universities, affiliating and examining. In Britain, in the meantime, teaching universities had developed. You know, universities of Cambridge and Oxford are essentially examining universities. They organize lectures, but they have nothing to do with syllabi. The syllabus, and the tutorials for the syllabus are conducted in colleges. So this was the system in England when the Indian universities were first established. But now, this is, at that time, by Curzon's time, the system has changed. So there was a demand accepted widely held demand that universities should also be teaching institutions. They should also have teaching departments, postgraduate departments, they should give MA degrees and ultimately the PhD degrees. So an act had to come, but Curzon added to this act a large number of draconian provisions. The college could be disaffiliated because of the political actions of its students. In the academic councils where only teachers up till now sat, college representatives, there will be government nominees. Government would have to the final say in matters like disaffiliation of colleges and disciplinary action against them. Basically, this was aimed at Bengal because one of the major areas where educated people had very strong nationalist views were Bengal. You could judge it from the kind of newspapers and weeklies that came out in Bengali and in English. Although in a sense the Universities Act was an All India Act, but major protests came in from Bengal. The effect of the Indian Universities Act was the very opposite. Whereas up till now there was little political activity in the colleges, and Curzon had hoped by that the Indian Universities Act that level of political activity would also be eliminated. But the result was opposite. It turned out to be a provocation. Even English professors, that is Englishmen who were professors of these colleges and were teachers in these colleges, signed statements against the university. And almost in every college in Bengal and Bihar, meetings were held denouncing the act. So you could not disaffiliate every college in Bengal and Bihar. You could not dismiss all principals of these colleges. And it came to be known then that the government threat through the Universities Act was hollow. And in fact, the draconian provisions of the Universities Act could not be put into effect because of the fear of response that already obtained now in 1990. So Curzon then went into his second project, and that exploited a division with which the government of India, British government, had been playing since 1987-88 under Dufferin for the first time. That is to say, trying to incite certain classes and communities against the Congress. First, it was to incite the landowners, the landlords. It was a persistent policy of the British government to tell the landlords that the Congress wanted equality, that once the Congress became important, then their hierarchical status will go. As Sayyid Ahmad Khan put it, Tarzid will sit with the great Rajput Rajas and the great Raises, Rausa. So that kind of approach. The second approach was to try to divide Hindus and Muslims. And Bengal was a very good ground for attempting. First of all, the major zamindars in Bengal were Hindus, whereas the peasants in majority were Muslims. The zamindars usually lived in the villages where they had their great houses, and therefore it was expected, an expectation which was not fulfilled, that the zamindars of Bengal would prefer to have their lands under a government, under a provincial government, on which they had, would have more influence than in Calcutta, where the influence of educated people, lawyers, merchants, Indian middle classes seem to overwhelm zamindar or landlord. The second attempt was to show that the eastern Bengal province, once separated from the rest of Bengal, would look after the interests of Muslims, particularly Muslim zamindars, much better than they could be looked after from Calcutta. There was also an attempt to get support of the English tea planters. Assam was to be paired with Bengal, so that English planters, tea planters, would be away from the eye of Calcutta. Their misbehavior with their Santhal and other tribal laborers, men, women, and children, was so oppressive that any government centered in Calcutta would have to pass some rules or take some steps against it. Whereas if the center was at Dhaka, then they would get away. So the province of Eastern Bengal and Assam was created to, in the interest supposedly of zamindars, Muslims, and tea planters. This partition of Bengal came in 1905. West Bengal, Bihar, and Odisha were separated. That continued to be known as Bengal Presidency, with the capital at Calcutta, but Eastern Bengal and Assam. Now, the partition of Bengal raised opposition from two quarters. One was very vocal, but of course was in fact, just as it was vocal, it was local. That is to say, it was from Calcutta. In Calcutta, everyone, whether Hindus or Muslims or lawyers or merchants, were against partition, because even Muslim lawyers will have to move to Dhaka. Their clients were in Eastern Bengal. Therefore, the early meetings were more regional. Those in Calcutta protested, those in Dhaka jubilated. But then, as it became clear that there were political intentions to protect Assam tea planters, to raise the Muslim-Hindu issue, and particularly because the partition was greatly welcomed in Muslim circles favorable to the British government. Therefore, a nationalist opposition, which in practice in Bengal was mostly now confined to the Hindu population of West Bengal and Eastern Bengal, came in. Now, this anti-partition movement, despite having its base, popular base among Hindus, nevertheless, in its opposition to the partition, took a non-communal position. That the opposite, that the partition was an attack on the unity of Bengal, that the partition was an attack on the national movement, that the partition of Bengal wanted to divide Hindus and Muslims so that the English would be favored, and so on. It was the second round, the second wave of the anti-partition struggle, which greatly surprised the government. The slogan of boycott was given. And under leaders like Bipin Chandra Pal, huge meetings were organized and there were strikes in the colleges, and large processions were taken out, and a boycott of British goods was announced. This was the first time that the method of boycott, which had come from Ireland, was used in India. Boycott of all British cloth, all British goods. If other goods, if these goods were not made in India, could not be found in India, then the goods made in countries other than India. The Congress at the same time met in Banaras, and the moderates were in a quandary. They opposed the partition of Bengal without venturing to go so far as to adopt boycott. They supported the boycott movement, but only in West Bengal, and only in Bengal. But they were forced to decide that the next session of the Congress would be held in Calcutta. The Calcutta Congress was presided by Dadabhai Nauroji, who, if you remember, also had presided at the second session of the Indian National Congress. He was a figure under whom all could gather. Tilak and his supporters also now attended the Congress. The Congress was there for the first time after many years, a united body. Curzon was gone now, but Curzon's policy, as I previously said, had resulted in the opposite, in a result opposite to his own. Congress was not being carried to the grave, it had in fact reunited. And the Congress session at Calcutta passed a number of resolutions. For the first time, the Swadeshi policy, which included not only boycott but the development of Indian industry, became a major slogan. One of the major results, the positive results, was the establishment of the Indian firm Bengal Chemical. At that time, the major Indian firm. And the establishment of the Jadavpur Institution to train Indian engineers. Remarkably, the Jadavpur Institution was entirely financed, funded by private donations. Then there was demand for Indianization. Indianization of services, Indianization of education. This Indianization meant that Indians should be taken into the civil service. Examination should be held in India. Indianization of education meant that instead of history of Great Britain, the history of India should be taught. Indian languages should be taught. So, the slogan of Indianization had nothing to do with the slogan that BJP later raised and said that this is the same slogan as was given by the Indian National Congress in 1906. That Indianization was a counterattack on total anglicization of Indian education and Indian civil services. It also demanded more expenditure on health and education and so forth. You can see that independence was not among the demands. But the crucial demands, all about Indianization, about Swadeshi, all attacked the British policies currently followed. Now, the British government, of course, did not make any concessions. On the other hand, they began to arouse communal feelings. They encouraged both they are loyalists and those who like Madan Mohan Malviya, who had eaten both camps. Madan Mohan Malviya could be in the Congress as well as in the Hindu Mahasabha. He established Hindu Mahasabha in 1906. Whereas when he came to the Congress, he was one of the moderate leaders. Then MAO College management first organized the Shimla deputation, which went and saw and thanked the Viceroy for the kindness of the British government in partitioning Bengal. Those who know Urdu should read a poem about this delegation by Akbar Allahabadi. Their major argument was that since Muslims were more loyal than Hindus, obviously because Hindus were supporting the agitation, were behind the agitation against the partition of Bengal, and were behind the Indian National Congress. So since Muslims were more loyal, they should get more concessions than they were quite happy with British rule as it was, but if any concessions were given to Hindus, Muslims should receive more concessions. This was a very interesting position. You are as happy as matters are. If you have no voice, you are not. The English are looking after you. But if Hindus have a voice, we should have two voices. Double their voice. That was the argument of the Shimla. And then this was followed by the establishment of the Muslim League of Thar, about which Akbar Allahabadi said that actually League is the N removed from Ali. The Ali got predominance among the Muslim League was fairly obvious. But for that very reason, the Muslim League remained a weak organization, fairly weak organization, until 1914 when it entered into the famous Congress League Pact at Lucknow, which I shall come to. So, now, the failure of the mass agitation against the partition of Bengal in 1905 and 1906 led to two developments. First of all, communal riots in East Bengal against him. These were the beginning of modern communal riots. Often, peasants' dissatisfaction with conduct of zamindars merged into Hindu-Muslim differences because most of the peasants were Hindus and the zamindars were. Most of the peasants were Muslims and the zamindars were Hindus. But ordinary Hindus were also attacked, so the class explanation doesn't meet the case. On the other hand, on the nationalist side, there came into picture what came to be known as Hindu nationalism or revolutionary terrorism. It's theoretical, it's theoretician, was Aurobindo Ghosh. He wrote G-H-O-S-E. So you can write Ghosh or you can write Ghosh as well. Aurobindo Ghosh. He had been in service in Baroda in the 1890s and he had then written articles, essays, in which he had argued that the core of Hinduism was not Ahimsa or not dharma, morality, but shakti, power, drawing his inspiration from Durga Vashti. He spoke of shakti as the basic tenet of things. And this being the case, Hindus should take to violence against British. It is important to note that he didn't say anything against Muslims. To him, the opponents of Hindus were the British. While he stood on the sidelines in Calcutta and ultimately Siyar Das was his lawyer at his trial, got him acquitted, the other followers, who actually made bombs and carried out acts of terror, were took to the same to that belief that by assassinating and murdering British officials, they would create a situation where there would be an uprising. Previously, Chapekar brothers in 1897 had assassinated in Pune the late Commissioner Rand, and so they became heroes. They were hanged. Both the Chapekar brothers were hanged. But they now became heroes of the Bengal terrorists. Their major martyr was Khudaram Bose. Who in 1908 tried to assassinate an unpopular English official, but by mistake assassinated two English women and was hanged. Others also who took part in these activities either went to death as martyrs, forward, sent to long imprisonments. It's important to notice, however, that despite the riots in Bengal, these Hindu terrorists or revolutionary terrorists did not take any measure of this. Their sole opponent were the British. And this is an important point to remember when one talks about Hindu nationalism in post-partition. Now, the British response was not to give at that time concessions on partition. Ultimately, they gave that last concession also. But to try to maneuver and to offer political concessions. There were, in fact, public appeals by Morley, the Liberal Secretary of State for India, to the Congress moderates to talk with the British government. And this bore fruit. And at the next Congress, in December 1907 at Surat, there was a split between the moderates and the extremists. Since Tilak was the most unpopular person among the moderates, a moderate threw a shoe at Tilak. But like President Bush in Baghdad, Tilak was very quick and he jumped back and the shoe struck another moderate. The moderates thereupon raised the noise that the extremists, that is Tilak supporters, had attacked them with shoes. And on that pretense, they expelled the minority, the moderates were in the minority, they expelled the majority, Tilak and his followers, from the Surat Congress because they controlled the hall. And so the unity that had been seen in Calcutta a year earlier was shattered in Surat. Tilak was then put on trial by the British government and sentenced to 6 years of imprisonment. He therefore became one of the first Indian nationalist leaders to go and serve a long stretch of prison. On his arrest, there was a general strike in Bombay, the first general strike in the country's history of Burma. This was also remarkable in the fact that the weaving sectors in Indian textile mills at Bombay were very largely manned by Muslim workers, but they also came out in protest. The political promises which the British government made were enshrined in the Indian Councils Act of 1909. In 1909, two classes received most favorable treatment. One, landlords. Landlords were given extra votes in UP, Bengal, Madras Presidency, Bombay, they were given extra votes. Then Muslims. Muslims would vote both in general constituencies and in Muslim constituencies. Their voting rights, they did not require the same qualifications as non-Muslims for Hindus for their voting rights. Manifestly, the act was indefensible. It was clearly to reward those who had supported the British government, the two classes, one the community and its leaders, and the second the landowners. And at that time, you know, the major Muslim leaders were, of course, landowners, so the two classes merged. Moderates also gained because there was representation in the Legislative Council now. Up till now it was only provincial councils, but now it was direct voting for the Central Legislative Council. So there was something for the moderates also. And for that reason, while the moderates criticized the discriminatory features of the Act, they did not reject the Act, they did not boycott the Legislative. That was the position of Gokhale. Gandhi's position in South Africa was even more positive. He said it was wrong for Hindu leaders, as I think I mentioned yesterday, to criticize the act for providing concessions to Muslims, because if a brother gets a more favorable treatment, why are you? So it was not. There was farsightedness, considerable farsightedness in leaders like Gokhale and Gandhi. But Tilak and others, or Tilak supporters rather, because he was in prison, bitterly denounced the act of 1909. Now, seeing that the act of 1909 was burning boats with section of the moderates, like Malaviya, Hindu Mahasabha people, and also with other moderates who could be won over, the British government decided in 1911 to annul the partition of Bengal. Bengal was made into one province, two leads the Assam planters. Assam was made a lieutenant governor's province, separated from Bengal. Bihar and Odisha became one province. And so the partition of Bengal was made. To hit at Calcutta even now, Delhi was made the capital. So that the people of Calcutta should not celebrate, they were deprived of being the capital of the country, because it was felt that nationalism was so strong in the capital, while Delhi was a ruined city, so it could be much better controlled by the British government. Now, the annulment of the partition of Bengal pulled the carpet below from the feet of the Muslim League, because partition of Bengal had been the cornerstone of the celebratory declarations of the Muslim League. And from here onwards, there was a tendency for a large section of the Muslim League to shift towards the Congress. Shaukat Ali and Muhammad Ali were prominent, and then Abul Kalam Azad, the leading Urdu journalist at that time, particularly underlined the fact that Muslims had trusted the British government and had been betrayed, and their real friend was the national movement. This tendency was helped by the fact that the British imperial policy was turning very hostile to Turkey. And while most Indian Muslims at that time did not believe that the ruler of Turkey was really their Khalifa, nevertheless, they had great sympathy for Turkey as a Muslim power, and they looked at with great anxiety as Turkey was being attacked from all sides and with the support of Britain and France as the major powers. Now in 1911, the Indian medical mission was sent. It was, you will notice, not a Muslim medical mission, but an Indian medical mission. It had Dr. Ansari, as it said, but it is the Hindu and Christian doctors and nurses. And this was an important piece of action. For the first time, an intervention in international matters by the National League. The cause of Turkey, therefore, became, hereafter, became a common cause between the Muslim League and the National League. The loyalist elements in the Muslim League were increasingly isolated, because it was very difficult for them to defend the British government with regard to Turkey. Now, when World War II broke out, the situation in India was roughly as follows. Tilak had been released, and he was trying to build a united national movement once again. Moderating his demands from Swaraj to Home Rule, and willing to give large concessions to Muslims in order to bring Muslim League into the alliance. It was at this time that he made the famous statement that had he not been born in Maharashtra but in northern India, Akbar not Shivaji would have been his hero. He made it clear that his major enemy, as for the national, as for the revolutionary leader of Bengal, was the British government, and that concessions to the Muslims should be fought. He was also willing to make concessions to the moderates. And the moderates, having found that actually their place, their being in the Legislative Council had not influenced British policy on the ground at all, but particularly being disillusioned by the Act of 1909. And therefore they too wanted a compromise with the extremes. So there was a tendency towards a coalescence of forces, coalition of forces within the national. On the ground, several an important movement had arisen. It was partly but not wholly independent of the revolutionary terrorism of America. This was partly, this partly took the form of the Badr movement. Now the Arabic word Badr, G-A-H-A-D-R, there is no vowel at the end, but in Urdu and in ordinary Urdu it is pronounced Badr, means perfidious action, treason. And it had been used for the rebellion of 1857 as a translation of mutiny. But Ghadar had been adopted for use by Indians for the rebellion of 1857 as well. So by 1911, Ghadar had become a hallowed word, a word meaning revolution rather than mutiny. And it's particularly important that Punjab, which had largely remained passive in 1857, now saw in the Badr of 1857 their ideal movement, which they wished to repeat. So, Lala Hardayal and some others from Punjab formed the Hardayal, the Badr party in the United States. And they issued a paper by the name of Badr. But in India, it took root because of a peculiar incident, which is there in your synopsis, the Kumagata Maru incident. Kumagata Maru was a Japanese ship which a number of Punjabis, the bulk of them Sikhs, along with a sizable group of Muslims, hired for Canada, Vancouver. According to British law, all British subjects could migrate to Canada. But when this ship reached Vancouver, it was turned back. And it came back in Calcutta. And when these passengers landed there with their families, then there was a clash with the police. They were fired on and 20 died. It was this incident which set Punjab afire. And from here, Jallianwala Bagh was one almost connected story of unrest in the Punjab. Badr, those who joined the Badr movement carried out a large number of amount of subversive activity. They used to be called not Sardars if they were Sikhs, but Babas. So being a Baba in the Punjab for a long time was a hero's time. When the war broke out, there was a large contingent of Punjabi troops in Singapore. And when in 1915 they were asked to go to France, they mutinied. They killed their British officers and declared that they would not go to. They They were probably not Vadarais themselves, but they raised the banner of Vada. They said that we are joining the Vada. 44 of them were executed in public. They were all Sikhs except the first four, who were their leaders, who were all Muslims. A curious episode, tragic episode, but a curious episode of communal living. In fact, the British regretted later that they publicly executed them, because their fortitude created a very great impression on the people of Singapore. Now, the Singapore Mutiny was the first mutiny against the war in the world. And therefore, it has a position in world history, particularly in the history of World War. A number of persons connected to the Vada movement had gone abroad, and they had formed groups, which there is no time to discuss here. But certainly the large number of foreign Indians who had immigrated abroad and who now joined this so-called revolutionary terrorist movement outside India is astonishing. From Aligarh, Raja Mahendra Pratap, an old boy of the MU College, was a member of the first independent government formed in Kabul. Another, not connected with Aligarh, but famous revolutionary, was Barkatullah Khan, who had already been in exile for a long time in Japan, in Malta, and in Bristol. He also was a member of that. So there was also outside India a ferment. And this naturally influenced the progress of the national movement. First, the Congress and the League both met in 1915 in Bombay. And there they decided to meet at the same time at Lucknow in 1916. In 1916, Tilak, in a famous gesture, threw a blank paper to the Muslim League leaders to ask them what they wanted, so that should be given. Ultimately, the compromise was that Muslim League would support Home Rule and Congress would support separate electorates, in which Muslims would get more than their share of vote. This was the compromise of the Lucknow session of the Congress and the League, and that's often called Lucknow Pact. The two major features was the acceptance of Muslim League of the slogan of Home Rule. Up till now they were saying that they were quite satisfied with British government. Now they said, we accept that the object of movement is Home Rule. Congress accepted the principle of communal electorate. Tilak and Annie Besant, however, could not agree, and they formed among themselves how to carry on anti-British propaganda, and they formed two rival Home Rule Leagues. Annie Besant was an English labor leader who had come to India and was one of the Congress leaders, and she was a moderate of the moderates, and therefore she formed a separate moderate, Home Rule League. But even she was not acceptable to the British government and was arrested. These Home Rule Leagues were important for conducting propaganda on Indian issues, including the treatment of them. Now, as the war came to a close before I come to Gandhi. As the war came to a close, the position of Turkey became crucial. Turkey had joined Germany and Austria in the war against England and France. And now when England, France and America were victorious, they wanted to occupy Turkey. And it was here in 1918-1919 that the Turkish question became crucial in Indian politics. But before I come to that, I would like to discuss the arrival of Gandhi and Gandhiism. I'm sorry, I will need to take more time than I took yesterday, but you will have to bear with that because the period to be covered is very long and eventful. Now, most of the facts about Gandhi, I hope, are known to you. His birth in 2nd of October 1869 at Porbandar. His conservative background, his departure for England to get a bar so that he could practice in India. No lawyer could practice in High Court unless he was a barrister. His major ideas were shaped, as he acknowledges, in England. Because in England, towards the late 1880s when he was there, through the vegetarian movement, because he was a strict vegetarian, he met Christians who believed in non-violence and peace, and he read the New Testament for the first time. He was overwhelmed by the New Testament. And particularly its message of peace. And he then read the Gita in English for the first time and tried to read. Actually, he said he read the same thing in Gita as you find in New Testament, but you have to force yourself to read the same thing that you find in the New Testament in any other religious text, because New Testament is unique. So in any case, he tried to read in the Gita the message of peace, the message of compassion that the New Testament. And he was deeply influenced by Dada Bhai Nauroji's speeches. He said he attended every speech of his quietly, coming back, having feasted in the air from that speech. So he was converted to Indian nationalism along with the message of peace, the message of peace. Now, on coming to India, He was not successful very much as a barrister, and therefore he accepted an assignment from Dada Abdullah and Co., a Muslim Mehmet firm, to represent them in South Africa in cases. It was there that he immediately got involved in the racial question, which I will not say much because of lack of time. Indians were a small minority, but they were mainly laborers and traders. Among traders, Muslim Gujaratis were very prominent. Among workers, there were ordinary Gujaratis, people from East UP and people from Tamil Nadu. He began to organize them. Gradually, first he wrote a defense of the trader, but soon he found that the poorest of the poor were in fact the people who needed his most. He established the Natal Indian Congress in 1895, and then his agitations began, from minor agitations, which were minor successes, to major ones. His entire theory of political action was shaped in South Africa. Mobilization. Perhaps because Indians were in a minority, their demands had to be very moderate. But since they were in a minority, for that moderate demand, they had to go to the extreme lengths. And here, Gandhi shaped the kinds of struggles that he would later on pursue in India. Ultimately, I will only describe his last struggle. That was against laws passed in the Union of South Africa, against which not only discriminated against Indians, demanded identity cards, but also questioned their marriages. Their marriages were being declared illegal. And it was here that the greatest movement against South African racial laws was undertaken by Gandhi. 200 women went to prison, so that there was no room left in South African prison for women. Then 2,000 workers, including 50 women, made a huge great march from Natal into Transvaal. They were miners, led by Gandhi himself, and they couldn't put 2,000 in prison, so ultimately Smuts surrendered, and the demands, which were in fact clearly moderate, that the marriages should be recognized, identity cards should be cancelled, all Indians should not be made to pay a yearly tax for remaining in South Africa, all these things were conceded, and in 1914, having won this battle, Gandhi decided to come to India via Britain. Now, he had already put his ideas in a written form in Hind Swaraj, which I have mentioned before, in which he accepted the nationalist critiques of British rule, but did not accept the moderate conception of India as a constitutional democracy. On the other hand, he wanted in Hind Swaraj to go back to the India of the past, which according to him was neither a Hindu India nor a Muslim India, but it was an India in which Bashas and Rajas and Pandits and Mullahs served the people. Such an India had never existed, but Gandhi insisted that there was such an